Meldac, Life Planning, and Lenar's Mercenary Force on Game Boy, circa 1990. And as always, if he's watching this, Rob Hall from Bitbar, this is for you. Before I kick things off, I'd like to dedicate this latest review to the following: Brooklyn Interactive Group, Somerville Media Center, Lynn Community TV, Cambridge Community TV, Kenzie Bach, Boston City Councilor District 8, MIT, Harvard, Lauren Pespisa from Renters Radio and Antisocial Conditioning, the Letterman Family, the Mount Vernon Kid, Chavez Slovakia, Blasphemous HD, Mario B. and Nicole, Arlington Community Media Incorporated, Belmont Media Center, James Rolfe and Mike Betsay from Cinemassacre, Ian Bergeson from 16-Bit Heroes, Matt Lister from Dover, New Hampshire, Matt and Sarah from Clovis, California, Gabriel Jada Bedencourt, alias Riley Sky 100, Jack Cardinal from Mason, Michigan, Boston 8-Bit, Tryhard, Sam Mulligan, Geekbeat Radio, High Energy Vintage, Disaster Piece Theater, Boston Open Screen, Jules Carosa from Genoa Films and Goliath Post, and finally, Bitbar Salem, made up of Alan, Kaltoff, Clark, Spackman, Ziggy, Flum, etc. Anyways, with those out of our system, onto our main premise. Set during the Shogunate era of the mid to late 19th century, the Japanese countryside has been mercilessly laid under siege by the vast armies and unparalleled sorcery of the Lord of Darkness, thereby oppressing the peaceful population with nothing but famine, pestilence, plague, and God knows what fucking else, and threatening those who challenge the Lord with an inevitable, searing death penalty. Just when all seemed lost, Tokugawa the Great Shogun had a vision of a small band of rebel warriors that defied all the Dark Lord stood for during his recent meditation, following which he set out to recruit and assemble the five bravest and most experienced rebels in the country: a ninja, a samurai, a mystic, a monk, and a servant, by the names of Tora, Take, Sakura, Nenbo, and Kichi, individually, thus putting his ultimate dream into action, unleashing none other than the unstoppable Mercenary Force. Gameplay-wise, what better way to classify this than just a horizontal on-ground shmup? It gets a title in Natsume's Pocky and Rocky, Square Enix's King's Knight, and Hudson Soft's Adventures of Dino Riki, except they're all vertical and like what we're about to look at. And even Wolf Team's Final Zone, except it's isometric, in which you hire and send out one of the five possible fighters to combat every adversary and minion terrorizing medieval Japan, except in groups of four or less. Upon starting, you're provided 5,000 yen to assemble your squad, in which case you'd have to sacrifice the following mandatory amounts: 1,000 for Tora the Ninja, 800 for Take the Samurai, 700 for Sakura the Mystic, 1,200 for Nenbo the Monk, or 400 for Kochi the Servant. Your assembled party is then faced with wiping out every adversary in their way. Other opposing soldiers, samurai, ninjas, kamuso monks, you name it. Random animals including tigers, fish, frogs, bats, and other mystical beings including demons, monsters, giant centipedes, and the like, while protecting their asses at all costs. While the D-pad commands them to haul ass wherever, as expected, B shifts their formation or cancels directed to any menu or visit. Ditto for select that forces you to swap around the leader's position. A fires off their desired weaponry or confirms any purchase that is if you're visiting any shop, which I'll get to in a moment. And upon pushing B and A simultaneously, a spiritual deity is summoned, dependent on which character you're controlling, except for Kochi the Servant, who ends up detonating the shit out of his own pants, thereby not only serving as a screen nuke, but also rarely, if possibly, resulting in immediate suicide. Hence the spirits of wind, time, fire, and life, summoned by Tora, Nenbo, Take, and Sakura, respectively. Their health can be replenished at nearby shops throughout each of the stage areas, depending on which remedy suits your warriors best. Tea, sushi, medicine, the works. 100 yen fortunes sold at shrines depending on your party's member arrangements and or progress. Hell, you can even recruit a tanuki near the end by getting an excellent reading, despite his health turning out to be far less than the others and lacking a spiritual deity transformation skill, not to mention visit temples that provide 3 extra health points on the house, and even the daibutsu, or the giant Buddha statue, to bring back any slain allies for either 100, 200, or 400 yen, and participating in a card game where the middle has to be selected. Oh, and the cursor speed depends on how much you paid beforehand. Other items to bear in mind are both a special scroll and scripture that changes any of your characters into either a ninja or a monk, worth 400 and 420 yen respectively. Getting to the formations your party is capable of experimenting with on the field, there's 4 of them: forest, fire, mountain, and wind. Feasible for advancing with very few casualties, concentrating firepower in the middle and exercising the best combat-heavy support in the most narrow terrains, displaying a wider attack range despite resulting in heavier casualties, and continuous attack power in wide-open spaces individually. They're intended for each fighter to adjust their overall attack and defense capabilities to their utmost advantage, and then some. At the end of each area, provided you've taken as far less damage as humanly fucking possible, a boss confrontation comes into play, featuring a multi-segmented sky dragon, a razor rat surrounded by fire, three relentless out-of-this-world behemoths, referred to as the Megacorn, a human-sized yet eventually giant oni beast, Iclops, a giant creature with one huge eye and multiple diminutive ones around it, and Deathworm, a demonic skeletal caterpillar-like creature, and finally, isn't it obvious, the Dark Lord himself, as he's way less forgiving than all the others. More than ever, it's imperative to micromanage the shit out of your entire party in terms of not only how much cashola you earn, or the extra items and or backup mercenaries you utilize, but more importantly, how often you'll experiment with those previously addressed group formations and avoid enduring a pissload of damage, because the chances are higher than both a Boeing 747 and space shuttle cross collision that every warrior in the party will end up having their asses lynched out of existence. And if they do, God forbid, it's an instant anti-continue game over. So I'd literally play to my highest, innermost strength if I were you. In spite of how often and how swiftly the Freedom Fighters get their asses handed back to them in a row of caskets, the controls are at the very least manageable to get oneself accustomed to, and as redundant and lacking in true depth as the gameplay vehicle is, it's far from a repulsive ass drag. Ain't that the motherfucking truth? Even with all those earlier recounted strategic abilities and remedial benefits, I won't go so far as to shoot myself in the goddamn foot regarding this game's overall challenge aspect and difficulty level, let alone expect it to kiss my ass in every which way if I were you. Also, no skill shaming intended, but as much of a pain in the testicles as Mercenary Force tends to be, in time you'll come to realize how much of the exact opposite it becomes, thanks entirely to an impeccable opportunity to master both the group formations and the enemy patterns, as well as the fact that your character will be instantaneously sacrificed out of existence if that summoning ability is used, hence why it's imperative to save said technique until the start of or during the boss fights, or better yet, avoid using it altogether, except if you're playing as Nenbo, the monk, whose spear can skip past barely half of any stage area, precisely 40% at most. What's even more, the scenery sets in every stage area, as it turns out,
are harmless beyond belief,
that you'll always end up being magically warped back onto the main path, though I always follow it to the very end no matter what, even after eliminating any immediate reinforcements in the motherfucking way. So what the hell's the goddamn point? And don't even get me started about the financial aspects involving having to hire more mercenaries in between every bloody fray and or rejuvenate those that have been horribly wounded, despite the occasional price raises, in which case you'd have to lean in close often to annihilate more opponents to earn more yen or hang back to avoid any further casualties. Shit, talk about a paradox beyond all reasoning. No, scratch that. A clusterfuck of tetrahedron, xenomorphic, koala fish, mutant bird, necrop slurping horse shit. Did I even forget to mention that there's three possible endings, depending on whether or not you've included Sakura in the group, and or used the level skip code at the start, specifically up select A and B, and start of the title. Oh, and you're best off avoiding the latter if you intend to avoid fucking yourself over. Beyond these, please take every key strategy I've pointed out thus far to heart, and refer to what I stated earlier regarding the absence of continues following the demise of your party since, isn't it obvious, I'm also avoiding my verbal redundancy like a god-fucking-damn nuclear war. As typical of any early Game Boy game from 3 decades back, specifically Bubble Ghost, Heiankyo Alien, another work of Meldac except reprogrammed by Hyperware, based on an original concept by the University of Tokyo's TSG, or Theoretical Science Group for short, now the Tokyo Science Group, not to mention Gargoyle's Quest, Quarth, Nemesis, Battle Unit Zeoth and the like, the visual aesthetics, while not much to go ape shit over today, are at the very least appealing, complete with every top-view scenery background reminiscent of the feudal Japanese setting this game portrays, just like Konami's Mystical Ninja, aka Ganbare Goemon franchise, and the aforementioned Heiankyo Alien, made up of able-bodied characters including the five Freedom Fighters themselves and their opponents, with the latter running the gamut from somewhat threatening yet not worth any effort whatsoever to holy motherfucking shit, you dare not cross their path or else! When we go into different buildings or scenes, the situations where you're being welcomed by their respective proprietors are nothing short of convincing, ditto for the title and ending cutscenes. Need I bring myself further to express more at this point? Music and sound-wise, despite not having a vindictive composer indicated at the end, my only guess is being Junichi Mizutari, also the founder of Lenar, or Yoshinobu Kasukawa of the infamous Deadly Towers, notwithstanding their non-involvement. While many may end up looking the other way regarding the differentiating, culturally inspired situational themes, I had no problem with them whatsoever. Pointless understatement serving as a deception for a profound comment aside, however, some of them tend to get redundant after at least 5 minutes, specifically the stage and boss anthems, but definitely not the shop, shrine, temple, and daibutsu themes. The sound effects also have their share of pluses and minuses, as they tend to clash with the themes in-game, because limitations, in spite of their obvious subtlety, amongst many other underlying characteristics that would have taken the liberty of hinting beforehand. Replayability-wise, thanks entirely to the following features, which, despite having already described them, why not force a final recap? Namely the attack characteristics of the five main Freedom Fighters, the formations used for better attack and or positioning capabilities, the financial system involving grinding for more cash while conserving some for necessary situations, cases in point, healing the party members, or resurrecting and or replacing any of them upon their demise, the hidden items and characters, multiple endings and the like, amongst many. I possess yet another firm, cast-iron belief that Mercenary Force is much more than a solid must-own in my eyes. And quoting Jeremy Parrish from Game Boy World, definitely a gem worth hunting down. Bottom line, you'd be a total dipshit to abandon this, another in the slew of miscellaneous, underrated classics from decades past. In summation, what's my final verdict? By now, it should be obvious why this, along with the aforementioned Heiankyo Alien and Zombie Nation, have been vastly overlooked upon release, that is until a decade before now. But why continue to flog a dead goddamn horse over it all? It may not embody the same impact as every other shmup out there, whether they take place on Earth, hence what I've been shooting off my K-hole about thus far, or in space, but it's pretty fucking high up there. A loose copy should run you 10 to 15 bucks, if possibly less, while a complete box copy commands 16 to 28 bucks. But either way, no matter how you slice it, just get your ass out there and fetch yourself a real adventurous fray with the Mercenary Force. Until then, this is the one and only Hardcore Retro God triumphantly signing off.